Are you thinking about becoming a mobile app developer? Well, in this video, we're going to talk about the different ways that you can earn an income as an app developer, the skills you'll need to build, as well as different options that you can take to become an app developer, as well as the pros and cons of each option. And lastly, we'll end off this video with actionable steps that you can take today to start down your journey of becoming a mobile app developer in 2022. Let's dive in. First of all, let's start with what mobile app developers do. They create mobile applications for most often Android and iOS. Now, oftentimes they focus on a single platform and become an expert iOS developer or Android developer, but there are also mobile developers that specialize in cross-platform technologies like React Native or Xamarin, for example. Being able to do more than one technology is a great way to gain a competitive advantage in the job industry. But if you're just starting out, I would recommend choosing a single platform to focus on first. Now, as a mobile app developer, they could be working for a large corporation, a small business, for themselves as a freelancer, or even as an indie app developer trying to publish apps into the App Store or the Play Store and trying to earn a full-time living that way. Either way, if you love building apps, then this is definitely a career to consider. There are broadly three different paths you can take as a mobile app developer. Let's take a look at each one and dive a little deeper. Now, the first and most obvious path is to get a job with a company. Now, as a mobile app developer in a company, your job will be to either maintain their existing suite of apps or to build new apps. But either way, you're helping this company move forward in the app industry. Your tasks can range from building apps from scratch, building new features for existing apps, fixing bugs, testing, or if the business is really small, you might be doing all of these tasks. Another path that you can take as a mobile app developer is as a freelancer. Now, as an independent freelancer, you are meeting with clients, you are understanding their needs and their requirements, you are coming up with a plan, and you are delivering that app from start to finish. Once you become a proficient freelancer, you may be able to handle more than one client at once. The apps that you build will vary from client to client depending on what they need, as well as the income and the scope of the apps. The nice thing about freelancing is that once you build enough of a name for yourself and enough of a clientele, you may be able to hire your own developers and start building a consulting company that way. The third broad path is working as an indie app developer. This is where you're coming up with your own app ideas, you are building them, you are then marketing them, creating the business model for them, and publishing these apps in the App Store, hoping to get users and to make a living on your own through the App Store. Now, this is attractive for a lot of people because you don't have to answer to any clients, you don't have to answer to any bosses, and you get to implement your own cool ideas. But on the flip side, this is also the riskiest option because all the revenue hinges on your ability to come up with a solution that meets a need in the market, as well as to market it so that people know about it, and then for people to use it and want to continue using it and give you their money. Now, the great thing about all of these three options is that you don't have to only select one. There are people who are working full-time for a company, freelancing on the side, as well as building their own app ideas for the App Store on the side. You can be doing all three options at once. However, do keep in mind that some contracts that you have with your full-time employer may not allow you to do freelancing on the side. So, obviously, you're going to have to make sure you're free and clear to do that. But usually, I don't see large companies putting clauses to prevent you from building apps on your own for fun and profit. Now that you know the three broad paths of a mobile app developer, let's talk about the different options you have to educate yourself and to learn the skills that you need to become one. So first off, in this day and age, there are so many options available for you to pursue this. It's not like in the past where you had to just go to school for computer science or computer engineering and learn this and then graduate and find a job. That is one path, that is the traditional path, and we're gonna talk about that. But another path these days is that you can enroll in an online program such as our CWC Plus, where you can learn how to build iOS apps. Or you might be following YouTube videos and reading books and sort of learning on your own. So let's dive a little deeper into each of these options and talk about pros and cons. The first option is to teach yourself or being self-taught. The nice thing about this industry is that it doesn't discriminate. You don't need a degree in computer science to get a job. It all hinges on what you've done and what you can do. So self-teaching is totally viable. Now, the good thing about this option is that you can learn at your own pace. If you have a busy schedule, if you have, you know, demanding kids or whatever the case may be, you can learn in your free time. Also, there are a variety of mediums that suit different learning styles for this self-teaching path. You can do videos, you can do books, you can do online classes, courses, and things like that. There's so many different options. You find the format that you learn best in. Now, the pros with this method, I think we already mentioned a ton of them, is that you can sort of learn at your own pace and there's a variety of formats available for your learning. And another pro is that typically these options are all, they don't cost as much as the other options that we're going to talk about. So this can be quite affordable. Now, the downside with self-teaching is that you may not have a guide or a professional, someone to instantly tell you when you're going wrong, or to help you, you know, break down some of those roadblocks that you're facing. And so you may end up wasting time going down the wrong path or getting stuck on something for a very long time. And also, don't forget that if you are not the disciplined type of person, this self-teaching method may not be good for you because it relies on your own motivation and discipline to make progress. The next option is to attend school or a university program for something like this. These days, universities offer mobile app development as a course that you can take. The nice thing about attending school for this is that you're going to have the assessments, you're going to have the deadlines, and there is a structure. It's delivered by a professional, hopefully, someone who knows what they're talking about, and all of the materials and the lessons, they're laid out in a clear path that gets you a result at the end. So I think that's the nice thing about courses and structured learning. Now, some of the pros of this is that you will have certification, like you're gonna have a diploma or a certificate or a degree, something that tells you, yes, you've completed these skills, you've been assessed, and you have these skills. Now, earlier I said that it doesn't really matter if you self-teach yourself when you're applying for jobs versus someone who graduated, but however, having that degree and coming from that program automatically does give a degree of confidence. I think still, I stand by what I said. Ultimately, it's going to depend on what you've done and what you can do. So I still think that demonstrated expertise is more important or has more weighting than where you graduated from or if you were self-taught. But if you do have that degree and that, you know, that program written on your resume, it does automatically let the reviewer know or the recruiter know that you have those skills. Or you should have those skills, I should say. Now, the cons. Enrolling in a university program or a college program is costly. Like, that's the flip side of this. It's going to cost a lot of money, and many students go in debt just to go through these programs. Now, whether or not that is feasible for you, that's up for you to decide. You know, also, there may be other expenses if your university is far away and there are travel expenses or you have to live abroad, for example. And if you already have a full-time job or you are a parent, it could be hard to make time for that sort of study. The third option is joining a coding bootcamp. Now, these bootcamps are short and sweet. It's kind of like the summer camps that we all attended as kids and we enjoyed, hopefully. It's fun to be around people who are on the same journey as you and you can learn off each other and figure things out together. Now, the pros to a coding bootcamp is that it's sort of in between the full-time university study versus the at your own pace self-teaching, sort of in between that. There still is a schedule. It could be like really intense for a short period of time, or it could be a couple of dedicated night classes per week, that sort of thing. So a pro for a coding bootcamp could be, if it fits your schedule and your budget, this could be a nice option to get started. It's got a little bit of that structure. It's got a little bit of that freedom of schedule. But it's also got that guidance that is completely missing from the self-teaching option. Now, in terms of cons for coding bootcamp, again, it really depends on your schedule. Even a few days a week could be too much commitment for you. And some bootcamps could still end up costing a lot of money. So make sure that you talk to people who have taken that bootcamp before or or read reviews about the bootcamp that you are thinking about joining. Don't just join up for any random one, because I think quality varies between different bootcamps, and you definitely don't want to pay all of that money and spend all that time and still come away with nothing. All right, now that you know the different learning options to develop the skills that you need, what are the skills that you need? So broadly speaking, we talked about iOS app development and Android app development. I recommend you to choose either or when you're starting and not try to do both, because that could be very overwhelming. Now here at Code with Chris, we focus on iOS app development, whether you are a beginner or you're an intermediate learning to gain even more skills. We've helped thousands of people build their own apps or get jobs in the industry and things like that. So I'm going to speak a little bit about the skills you need if you wanted to go down the iOS app development path. If you want to go down the Android app development path, just search for it on Google or YouTube, and I'm sure you can find different videos to help you. Now, as for iOS app development, the programming language that you're going to want to learn is Swift. Now, this is a relatively new language compared to other programming languages, but that's actually a good thing because it's modern and it's easy to read and it's not archaic. It will be a fun experience to learn Swift. So Swift is the coding side where you express the logic for your app. For the UI side, which stands for user interface, this is the visual elements that the user sees when they're using your app. There are two different frameworks that you can use. One is called UIKit, which is mostly the prevalent one right now. However, Apple has released Swift UI in the last few years, and this is sort of their modern take or upgrade, if you will, to UIKit. And so while not as widely adopted right now as UIKit, it will be in the future because that's the direction that Apple wants to move in. So if I were you and I was just starting out learning iOS app development, Swift is a given. You're going to have to learn that, but I would also focus on Swift UI. And lastly, there is Xcode, which is the application that runs on Mac. And this is sort of like the studio development environment where you write your code and you configure the UI piece. Essentially, that is the application where you use to build your apps. So you're going to have to learn your way around Xcode as well, but that sort of comes in time. If you're just learning Swift and Swift UI, you're going to be using Xcode anyways to do those things. Now let's touch briefly on how much you can earn as a mobile app developer. Your salary is going to depend which of the three paths that you choose, the ones we mentioned earlier on. But again, you can sort of mix and do a variety of these three paths. If you're working for a company, the average salary would be about $100,000 a year. As a freelancer, your rates could be anywhere from $20, $50, $70 an hour. It really depends on what you're comfortable charging and what you feel like your skill and your time is worth. Professional consulting companies charge their clients upwards of $150 an hour for their consultants. But obviously, as an employee to a consulting company, you're not getting that amount. You're just getting a small portion of that. As your own freelancer, you get to keep all of it. But then you also have to manage the client and you have to find your own clients and do all of that stuff. Now, when it comes to indie app developers building their own apps, releasing it to the app store and trying to make a revenue, it's really hard to say what their incomes can be, because it's even hard enough to get an app that is successful in the app store enough to earn any income. What I would say is search for some app case studies, successful case studies from other indie app developers, and a lot of them actually share their numbers and how fast or slow the growth of the app was. So immerse yourself in that space if you are thinking about doing it yourself, and I'm sure you can get an idea of how much you can earn. And as starting out, I would definitely recommend going down the path where you're looking for a job. You can always start freelancing and building your own apps on the side, and then once those things show enough promise, you can then quit your full-time job and pursue those things instead. All right, now we've arrived at how to get started with your own mobile app career, an actionable step-by-step plan to start down the journey of becoming a mobile app developer. Okay, step one is to get the basics. So we talked about the skills you need to learn depending on if you want to do iOS app development or Android app development. We talked about how to get those skills, whether you want to self-teach, do a bootcamp, or do a university program. Step one is getting the skills. And this is kind of the hard part because you're going to have to put in the effort. You're going to have to make the time in your schedule to study and to practice. But if you stick with it, you will slowly learn the skills. This stuff is not rocket science. It's just how much time have you dedicated to learning it? So it's possible for anyone. Now, step two would be building a portfolio, because as I said, demonstrated expertise that you can show someone is more valuable than just, I've taken this course or I've taken this program, you know? So I would focus on filling up your GitHub account or actually releasing apps in the App Store, something that you can show an interviewer that you have done and that you have built. And if you don't know what to build for your portfolio, perhaps you can take some of the projects that you've built in your course or your program and put that in your portfolio, right? You could ask your friends if they have anything that they'd like to build. Anything, again, you can put in your GitHub account or publish into the App Store to link to. Step three is to craft your resume. Now, in the beginning, if you are new to this industry, you obviously won't have a lot to put on your resume, but focus on those personal projects. Focus on that GitHub account. Focus on those apps that you've published. Anything that you can demonstrate that you have the skills and you can do what you say you can do, that is going to be a plus. And finally, step number four is to start applying for junior jobs. Now, when you do this, just understand that right now, as you're applying for jobs, this is the hardest part because you have no experience. All you have on your resume is your portfolio. However, all you need is for one person to give you a chance. That's it. So you're gonna get 100 no's, but all you need is one yes. And as soon as you get that one yes, you get in there, you stay humble, you're there to learn, and you do a good job, that will then set you up for either a continued career growth at that company or an easier time to jump to another company later on when you have more experience. When you apply for jobs the second time, it's going to be easier. The third time, even easier, and so on and so forth as you mature in this app industry. Now, step five is just to stop watching this video and get started. If becoming an iOS app developer is something that you've always dreamed about, check out our playlist right there to get started for free. See if this is something for you. Thousands of people have taken this free 14-day app challenge and have really discovered that this is something that they want to do, as well as it's something that they can do. Building that confidence and unlocking those barriers in your head telling you that you can't do it, sometimes that is all that it takes to create a path that you never thought was possible. So go ahead, click there, watch it. Thanks for watching this video. I'll see you in the next one. Bye for now.